express. Good evening, everyone. Before we start, I'll just go through the usual housekeeping instructions. There's no fire alarm scheduled for this evening, so if the fire alarm does sound, we need to vacate using the marked exits and staircase. Congregation points us to the rear of the building on exchange flags. There's accessible toilets and out on the landing area just past the staircase. Can you put any mobile devices on silent, please? Recording of proceedings is permitted, and that permission of recording extends to the recording of the committee itself rather than any members of the public who had their permission. And it's for the duration of the meeting. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. Well, welcome everyone to the first of the year, municipal year, to the committee. We start off with a round of introductions, because we've got some new faces. Plenty of old faces, I'm about to say, but some new ones as well. Councillor Richard McLinden, Chair.
Councillor Liz Burrows.
Councillor Elizabeth Hayden.
Councillor Andrew Coleman.
Councillor Paul Kenyon.
Councillor Nick Small.
Councillor Steve Munby.
Councillor Nathalie Nicholas. Sandra Davis, Director of Public Health. Sue Rogers, Assistant Director of Adult Social Care. South Wales and Health Watch Liverpool.
He's a Grand Advisor member.
Lucas Hakadian, Advisory Member.
General Chief Officer of Liverpool CCG.
Fiona Islands GP Chair of Liverpool CCG.
Councillor Sarah Jennings.
Councillor Barbara Mace, deputising for Councillor Richard Campbell.
Thanks everyone. You may notice there's a third advisory member. We've now got Sarah's joined us from Health Option. Welcome, Sarah. Hopefully you have when you get to your actual appointment. Calling Peter, apologies now.
Yeah, as Barbara mentioned, we have apologies from Councillor Richard Kemp, from Alison Clark, Councillor Alison Clark, Director Martin Farron, Sue Rogers here for adults. Councillor Paul Brandt, our cabinet member, is actually making his way back from a trial in Derbyshire, and he is possibly able to join us very late in the meeting if we're still going. Councillor is new deputy, assistant cabinet member, Councillor Claire McIntyre, is actually representing Paul at an event, doing a live interview on Gwynarby Court at 6 o'clock, so she won't be able to attend that. Can I second it? Emily? Is that agreed, guys?
Yes.
Are there any I take it in the nobody else? That's what I should have asked in the first place. It's agreed, it's we can't have anybody else. Thanks, Steve. Right, we've got the appointments of advisory members who've already introduced themselves, which is Dorcas Acadian, Hazel Brown, and Sarah Thwaites. Can we agree those appointments, guys, please? Go on, Paul.
Thanks, Chair. I just wanted to ask a question on the appointment of advisory members.
Go on.
And what's the process in sort of recruiting our advisory members to this committee? Just because, a lot of them serve as a whole. My question was actually about having someone that's got some knowledge on mental health scrutinised in the committee. So just wondering how we advertise that out there to ask members. It's not every meeting, but for certain.
Yeah. Good point.
There's nothing actually in the constitution that mentions the advisory members. I think there might be something on education where there's a statutory advisory appointments if they have co-opted members, etc. But what this committee did, and I'm thinking this around about 12 years ago, they used the Liverpool community network to do some recommendations on what the committee might need in its sort of knowledge base, if you like. And Douglas and Hazel have been with us basically ever since that. There was a few more at that time. I think that's one from the Disability Network and that, and a couple of others put there, sort of some of them either didn't seek reappointments or weren't reappointed. And there's no real set in stone way of doing it. So you have got somebody you think will add to the depth of the scrutiny of the committee, then just send in something and we'll look at that. With the cabinet member, the director, the chair, and we can always put an appointment report to a future meeting.
Just to finish that off, the advisory members are not here representing their own organisation, they're here representing the city organisation. So, it gives us that extra help. So, each one is here as a representative of the various organisations. Our old colleague Sharon, she wanted to be one, but I said, "No, you can't. You have to be a representative." So if she wanted to join us, she could join us as a representative, say the voluntary sector. But then that's got to be agreed. So yeah, anyone can be an advisory member. So you've got someone in mind, then please put them forward, because it's the more the right. Any member. All right, this is the stage where we have the cabinet member update, but he's not here, so it's tabled, obviously. And what I'd ask you to do is, if you've got anything later that you want to raise, then raise it now, and then we'll do it anyway. But other than that, you can just email Peter, and we'll make sure that it goes in the minutes. Okay, so go on.
To be honest, Sandy, you might have answered anyway, because about me, Transforming Choices event, because I went to it as well, and it was really good actually, has some really good lessons, and I just wondered whether, are we looking at how we expand that model, because it does go down so well, obviously it's very resource intensive, so I just wondered if you knew whether we were looking at doing more with that. I'm not sure if Sandra wants to do a question.
I mean, this is a service, it's a commission joint between ourselves and public health, public health's responsibilities in terms of commission services and ourselves in terms of care support for vulnerable adults. So Transforming Choices, along with a whole range of other services, are part of our commissioning programme. In fact, we've only just recently recommissioned our addiction recovery services. So this will form part of that programme.
Just to say that we are reviewing it all the time to ensure that it meets the needs of the city, because obviously we know that the needs are changing constantly and we need to reflect that in what we're commissioning. And also some of the joint commissioning work that we're doing will also help us to look at how do we make sure that we've got everything right across all the different commissioning strands of the city.
On Paddington Village, which is one of the things Paul's mentioned in the report, but I just thought it'd be useful. I'm quite close to this because it's in my on some of this, but I think it'd be useful if this committee could have a presentation around what the health impacts of this, some economic development impacts of it.
That's a shareable presentation.
But also particularly around the pros and partners and rural college and physicians, what impact is that going to have clinically and on the health of the city? I think it is really positive news for the people.
I think we need you for with some slides.
Piece of my thunder, because I was actually going to ask if we can actually go and visit as a committee basically and go down there. So instead of them coming up here, we can actually go and in future, in terms of the Paddington Village, in terms of the health, if committee would be allowed to go
there. I'm aware that the cabinet went on a visit about 2 or 3 weeks ago, so if, you know, I'm sure we could arrange something.
Okay, anyone else? Okay, so if you've got any questions, guys, on the rest of the report, we just send them through to Peter and we'll make sure that they get included in the minutes. Thank you. Can we agree that the calls be reported? For now. Okay, thanks, guys. Minutes of the last meeting, these are on pages Peter and I of the agenda, which took place on the 16th of March. Any accuracy or matters of advice that you'd like to give to those minutes? Everyone happy with that? Thank you. Can you leave them then, please? Thank you. We're flying through this. Question time, item 7, which is there. If that question was by yourself, Sarah, are you happy with the answer? It's on your table, it's in front of you, the question and answer session. Item 8, crikey! It's the CC update bulletin, and Jan, these are on page centre 14 of the agenda. Jan?
Thank you, everybody's read the report. I think, obviously, we are keeping them close to conversations.
Jan, can you get that mic a bit closer, please?
Sorry. We're obviously working closely with providers in terms of the hospital merger and process around that. I was expecting some announcements today over the appointment of the new chair, but I've as yet not seen anything, so I don't think anything's been made public. I guess that's a question from anybody. We've been working on the rights campaign as a CCG, partly because we were approached probably over 12 months ago now from a large portion of the deaf community in terms of access to local services, and we did a report on some of the challenges that the community were having in accessing NHS services. So this is a kind of an awareness raising piece of work that we're doing to remind providers of their responsibilities to people with challenge in accessing services and what's available to enable people to make sure they can use appropriately. There's an update on where we are with the Primary Care Connect practices and the process we went through, and I'm pleased to say that now we've secured alternatives, medical provision for all those patients. So hopefully that will kind of progress as usual. We have our annual general meeting coming up very shortly. We'd encourage everybody to attend if you possibly could. The format is similar to last year, so we will be having some service providers on the day to help answer any questions about investments that we've been making or service developments or even to get blood pressure checks. There will be people there that can offer advice and support, and obviously we'll go through achievements that we've made last year as part of the formal process of the AGM, and I'm happy to take any questions.
Just to ask about the proposed hospitals merger, it says that you've done a number of events already, so I just wondered if you could give an idea of what kind of feedback you've had from people in terms of the proposals, and also any information, and maybe it's too far, but around impact on jobs, things like that, and the staff workforce, what impact will it have, do you know yet?
It's not CCG that's involved in the merger, we're just reporting on what trusts, the entry and the role have been have advertised so far. I haven't participated in any events myself, so I can't say what sort of comments are coming out in terms of any of the conversations, but I believe, I think, suggest that there are an entry, they're invited to a future meeting.
So I say, yeah, the rest of the rooms in there, that it's going to be in there for me, I'm going to be meeting.
So thus far, I think we're only talking about the management basis and the sort of the technical bit of stuff. When it comes down to services, definitely you want. That's where we get involved.
Annalise, I'll kick off a few of my questions. So, I was just wondering, and again, you might not be able to answer this, given what you just said, but if there was any group set up for staff to discuss the impact of this project, which was just a report or anything like that. I just want to say great work on securing for MVP practice, because obviously last year was quite a big concern for us, and I was wondering what mechanisms have been put in place. So is it still the same contract as before, and what's in place now to stop what happened before happening again? Is the difference on that? And again, I was just going to ask the chair if when the new management teams put together, this was a week in the
just in terms of the merger, we can't comment on what opportunities have been provided for staff. I think we need to ask the two organisations. I think staff are fully aware of the merger and there have been conversations going on, but I can't comment on any specific detail. In terms of the APMS contracts, yes, they are. The contracts were let for the remainder of the part of the contract that was outstanding from Primary Care Connect, given us notice. So it was for a 33-month contract period. They will be subject to further procurement as and when that contract expires. We're hopeful that the new provider has got sufficient in place to enable that to continue. I've said before, the committee is not my favourite group, but it is what we have, you know, available to us. And we will work with those providers that offer APMS to ensure that we can minimise providers taking the decision to withdraw from those types of contracts going forward, but I can't say that, you know, that would be the last one.
Hey, Jan, I just want to say that it's my least preferred route as well. It's got serious shortcomings. It's like temporary firm contract. And given the disruption that's already happened, especially in places like West Speed, if that contract fails, there's nowhere around for those people to go. Who is the provider now? Basically, how come they can do it and the ones can't? That's what we want this type of contract, and it's awful that that's the only contract that we can offer them, or that's the only contract that will work in that area. How can we stop? I mean, I think it's something to do with recruitment of staff. Are these new providers given safeguards about how they're going to ensure it's all staff?
Yeah, through that process, obviously we're conscious of failings from previous providers. So the question that we were asking of the bidders was, how are you going to secure more staff? What assurance can you give us that those staff are available? How quickly will they be imposed? And you know, the process was very robust in terms of ensuring that we were going to make a decision that had some legs to it, that would actually be able to provide a service for the period of the contract. There's a whole range of reasons why people will choose to work with various providers and what they can offer in terms of, you know, different types of employment opportunities, different skill sets, skill mix. You know, people want to work in an area where they've got a big team around them, and they could offer that kind of support. So we're hopeful that that will, you know, deliver for that area. Yeah, Westbeek is, as we say, a concern to us in terms of the type of premises that they're operating from, which was another choice as to why we struggled to secure premises. The alternative would be to disperse the list, and I was expecting that that would be probably the only alternative to us, and that will always remain an alternative. We can't secure provision on the basis of an APMS contract going forward. Setting up a new practice would be incredibly difficult, and this time we just you know, GPs to invest in new premises, etc. And, you know, the resource constraints that we've got, how, you know, viable it is another question. I don't know whether Fiona wants to add anything. She's a GP in the city and knows how difficult it is.
Yeah, I think it would be really unlikely that you would find anyone looking to set up a new practice at the moment, given the shortage of GPs that we've got here and nationally. So we'll continue to support that practice, watch what's happening, and what we don't want is any surprises. So we'll be in a constant dialogue.
Work around communities and populations as opposed to individual silos. So totally accept that. How that fits specifically with the findings on the Shore Slab report, I can't answer here and now, but we can look at how that, the measures that they've included within that would be measured in the report.
So, have you said in terms of time scale of pulling together? Any ideas?
Well, the community headings exist now, and we're building on those year on year. What may be worth bringing to the committee is the operational plan that we've recently signed off, because that includes investment in things like, you know, crisis services, CAM services, mental health services, which is building on the community care team models all the time.
So it's something you will bring, sorry?
Yeah, we will
bring back to the next.
Bring on operational plan. It went to the governing body, the CCG, at the end of May. So it's a public document already, but we're happy to do a briefing for the committee on the highlights of that report and then how all that will be monitored throughout the year.
So either the next meeting or the one after?
Yeah, fine.
Yeah, thanks, sir. Sorry about that.
Thank you, Chair. Thanks very much, John, for taking us through that. And my colleagues, in terms of, I'm quite scared in terms of, yes, we've gotten a provider for the practices, but I'm scared that what if they pull out again, and in terms of what's plan B. So last time you said the issue were about in terms of short-term contracts and in terms of staffing. So what have we done, what discussion have we had with these providers to make it more an incentive? Because I know getting GPs, it's not, and community GPs is not very, very attractive for most GPs or junior doctors who are looking to, you know, shape their career. What are we, what are you all doing, I think, really, in terms of making, so basically it's not going to happen again?
I think it's very difficult for us to give any assurances that it won't happen again. We are stuck with this method of contracting. And where we mentioned about the workforce issues, I think having a provider that's got other GP practices in the city gives it a little bit more resilience. So that is something that makes it a bit more attractive, but it's still not as resilient as a GMS contract. I completely agree. I think we have to have a conversation about, a big conversation about different approach to primary care and about it not always being a GP that you need to see when you've got an acute problem. Increasingly our nursing workforce are much more skilled up than they've ever been, and so the new GP contract that comes out, as well as us having nurse practitioners, is encouraging the employment of clinical pharmacists, paramedics in practices. There's physicians associates coming online, so I think we have to start having a conversation with the public about how to get the best out of the services that we have got, and allowing GPs to take a more sort of consultant supporting role, so running that multidisciplinary team and focusing their time on the more complex patients that do need to see a GP. So that's a conversation we need to have. But you've highlighted all of our concerns as well.
General medical services contracts and primary medical services contracts have to be held by a medically qualified practitioner registered with as a GP. APMS contracts were brought in to allow for other companies that don't have a medical qualified director but could employ GPs to run those services. It was brought in probably 10, 15 years ago when we started to see that there was potentially a workforce crisis, and this may be an alternative way to bring other models of general practice into the NHS. It's been successful in some areas and less successful in others, and I think my experience in Lancashire was that in, they struggled because recruitment in the north was more challenged than in the south. And I think Liverpool itself is kind of catching up now with that difficulty in being able to recruit. And they're not, even though they effectively are paid more under an NPMS contract, the GMS and PMS contract, they're still not as attractive because they go to the market every few years to be renegotiated. And that was, it was, it was brought in exactly for that reason.
You referred to a plan that you're going to bring back to us. In terms of this problem, which in terms of GP practices and the contract, is that in the plan? I would have liked to see that in the plan, seeing that that's a problem and that's something that we would need to work towards avoiding in the future.
I can't avoid having APNS contracts unless nobody bids for them. If nobody bids for them, then the only alternative we've got is to redistribute the list of patients to existing GMS PMS contracts. We've explained it to the committee before. These are the rules that we have to operate within. No matter what I put in the plan, won't change that. We've explained to you the process, and we went through it in quite a lot of detail last time, but. I agree, and as I say, from a CCG perspective, it isn't necessarily our preferred option, but we have to work with the framework that NHS England have agreed. We've only got delegated authority for general medical services. The authority for primary care medical services still sits with NHS England.
Do you have any feedback? Maybe I've asked this before, where I'm not sure if it was this issue or she wanted another one, but there's something else that came up right as well, working within a framework that doesn't work for us. Are we as a committee, in terms of political voice, can we send something back to say, you need to look at this, or is that just a waste of
time? I suppose we can, but we have to do that through poor MPs, and so we have to go down that route. Douglas, did you have your hand up?
Yes, I've got two comments really. Sorry. You know, Nick mentioned about show start. I just want to make a comment. I know where it's coming from as a midwife when show started, isn't it? We have to look at the parents. I know you are talking of integrated. Do you think those parents are the ones getting all these? Do they understand where you're coming from? So we need to do more public information before we can say show start. We haven't got money for that. We're doing integrated care. So please, don't, the children's centers and shows that they're very important to families. So let's put the families at the start. The other comment is to you are saying about talking to the public. You know, no matter how integrated care is, we, as the public, we go for the service, isn't it, the GP? And sometimes people get confused to say, I want to see my doctor. And then I'm being told, go and see that, go and see that. It's how we understand it. You go in the past, you see our doctor, isn't it? And you will see your doctor. So there is a lot of way that we need to inform the public. Every GP practice, you have a PPG, which is a patient participation group. On this side of the city, I'm in Bangalore. I belong to my GP PPG. And then they have a steering group that look at the PPG. You need to start using that network to talk to the public. Where are the users? Public are the users. We don't understand all this contract. All we want is to get better. All we want is somebody to see. And then, not just about medicine, there is social prescription now, which we can get. So we need a lot of work for the public and for the users.
For me, my probably spectacular levels of ignorance is one of the great tragedies of my life, that I know virtually nothing about APMS contracts. And I wake up every morning saying, thank God for that. But is there any wiggle room there in schooling? You said that you can only get out of it if nobody bids. I don't know if they have scoring mechanisms, but thinking about the dark arts of procurement, right? If you want to stop somebody buying a contract, you make money matter very little in the scoring mechanisms, and you put other quality things. So I don't know whether it's very rigid from the central or not.
It is quite a rigid process, and as a professionally qualified in procurement, I'm worried about the dark arts, I'm afraid. But it's not an issue of scoring. So what we have to do is advertise the opportunity to bid for these contracts in an open way. And if people bid for them, then as far as the market is concerned, there is a market there to be offered the contract to, and we would have to go through due process and due diligence to ensure that they are capable of delivering that service. And that's when the scoring comes in. It's heavily weighted towards quality, workforce, the outcomes that we want for that service. If there was no market for the service, then we would have to look at alternative ways of providing primary medical services to the population. That's what was meant. It's not about scoring of the bidders, it was about whether there is a market there to provide the service.
Yeah, it's just a comment for the committee that I know Jan and the CCG are well aware of. It's obviously patients in those practices have been through so many changes of a provider that their expectations are often quite low. But it's also an issue about the consistency of the care, because in some of those practices that have been too dependent on locums. And I think if we can start to see more regular GP space in those buildings, then we'll start seeing improvement in the actual care that's been provided and people's experiences of that, because it's not just keeping the practice in that building because it's local, because obviously we'd all like a GP that's local, but just as important, often more important, is getting that regular care from somebody that actually can provide oversight. And that, I think, has probably been lacking with so many transitions recently in those practices.
Services, and we know that now because of all the stuff that's going on with the measles at the minute. We've got a screening panel that's currently ongoing for this. No, we haven't, sorry, it's finished, haven't we? We finished that. We've had an update report, sorry, which is within there. And Sam, do you want to just round this off?
Yes, I just want to briefly talk through some of the key points that I think we need to make from this, because the report, we were asked for this because there was a lot of noise in the media about uptake and relations to anti-vaccination messages. So I just want to give a few key points really. Uptake is decreasing across all vaccinations, however, I think we have to be clear that in Liverpool we have good or very good rates. So we're not poor, but we're just slightly below the target in many of the areas. And that in itself is a concern, but something that we need to kind of keep abreast of. There are lots of reasons that are being given for that, and anti-vaccination is one of those, and there's been a lot of work with social media outlets to ensure that if people go on to social media and put in vaccination, that they're not automatically taken to, or in the first instance taken to, anti-vaccination messages. So there's a lot of kind of work that's gone on around that. However, there's also a view that it's not just about anti-vaccination messages, and I think we, the scrutiny panel, looked at what some of those reasons were, but I think we need to think that that's one of a number of issues that will impact on whether we meet our targets or not. In public health, we want to do some insight to look at what all of those issues might be. Some of the issues, and Public Health England have come out and said that there is a view that some of this is about a lack of information about how serious these illnesses are, particularly for children, but we're talking about adults as well. In the report, we've included children's and adults' vaccination, because obviously adults make the decisions or take the actions to get children vaccinated. So it's very much about the kind of family care environment in which they're in. So it's very important for us to look at both of those, and that's very important. The latest data from Public Health England does show nationally there is an increase in measles and mumps. The North West has some cases as well. It's always a concern for us because we're always at risk of an outbreak happening. But Liverpool, you know, that's very well managed. At the moment we're not seeing outbreaks, so you know we're doing very well around that. But I think we really have to push the benefits of vaccination, and there's a big campaign from Public Health England at the moment which is doing that and playing down the anti-vaccination message. And very clearly we want to do that because I think, you know, that we don't want that to take on any more traction than we think it has. But we really do need to kind of get across the message that these illnesses are serious. And I went on to Google this afternoon, just put in the disease illnesses that we're vaccinating against, and for every one of them they came up as this is a serious illness. So it's not about, you know, something that's, you know, is minimal. They are really serious conditions that we need to think about. So we do know that there's still a lot of confidence, a high level of confidence in our population around vaccinations, and that's what we've got to build on. So the report goes through all the vaccinations, looks at where there is a drop-off, and suggests some of the reasons for that. But as I say, we want to look further at how we might increase vaccination across the piece. Now, the programmes are the responsibility of NHS England, but of course, locally, we have a lot of information and connection to our local communities, so we want to make the most of that. The other issue is we still see the relationship between deprivation and uptake, so we really do need to think about how we are working with those communities that are deprived and where there is, we are showing reductions in rates that may be worse than other areas in the city. And it's similar for everything that we see in public health. You know, there is always an issue related to deprivation, and we really do need to work on that. So I think the message is we have very good rates in Liverpool. We have seen a drop-off, as nationally there has been a drop-off, but we need to make the most of promoting the benefits of the vaccine and, you know, what they actually do and what they prevent. And I'm happy to take any questions. That has been raised is around getting appointments in GPs, but I don't think that's the only issue at all. But we do need to consider that when we're looking at areas of low uptake. Is there something more we need to do to ensure that we're not all